Welcome to the Netflix. We are here at Techorama Live, and we've got a very special guest, Pete Brown. Hi, Pete.
Hey, everybody.
Thanks
Hello.
Thanks for being here.
Thank you.
Can you quickly introduce yourself for the viewers?
Sure. So I'm Pete Brown. I work at Microsoft in a group called Partner App Experience in Joe Belfiore's org.
Okay. Cool.
And I love Commodore computers.
Yeah.
So
yeah.
It's gotta have that.
I already asked whether or not it was an original or reprint, and it's a reprint, yeah. But it's still pretty cool.
And this isn't my normal. This isn't my normal jewelry, but I'm told that the closer it is to my mouth, the better.
The best
so
sound quality.
There you go. It's actually a very utilitarian beard that we have here. It's awesome.
Cool. I still have to grow one, so because I think this is really handy.
You've been working on that.
I've been working on it.
You can use a Velcro one with that one, right? Yes. There you go.
Probably.
So you do quite a lot with Windows, and we just had a new Windows release.
Yes.
October release, it's called, I think.
The RS5.
Yes. Yeah, so internally we call it RS5. Mm-hmm. It's the October 2018 update.
Okay.
The name actually makes sense for once, because it's October and it came out and it's the update. So
nice. People won't be
glad.
Confused.
Yeah, there's no confusion about that.
Paul Turok will love that, because he's always on, oh, why did you call it October when it's out in December or whatever?
Yes.
This will be great.
Which is funny, because the version is 18.09, which means September 2018, because we built it a couple of days earlier.
Yeah,
right?
Okay.
But yeah, so we just released that, and I'm very excited about that for a number of reasons. It's got a lot of kind of really neat features that have made it into this release that are, they're not things that you're going to see the minute you go into Windows, but they're kind of little delighters that are in there. Things like, if you hit the Windows key and hit the period, you get the emoji panel now. So any place that you can paste in text, now you can paste in emojis, which I don't use a lot of emojis in my stuff, but it does work in Visual Studio. So if you want to make a comment about somebody's code, there's a toilet emoji, there's all sorts of stuff that might be appropriate there. There's the cloud clipboard, which is super cool. And so we introduced, I think it was the previous version, clipboard history.
Mm-hmm.
So now, if you copy something and then you copy something else, it's not like, oh crap, I lost that thing I had before. You have
especially when you're
history.
Doing a demo or something like that. That could be pretty handy. Yeah.
Yes, we had actually one thing that was funny is when we were demonstrating this before, we forgot that we had copied a password onto the clipboard, so we hit Windows V, and then up pops the password for everybody to see. We're like, no, you didn't see that.
So that also allows me to copy from one laptop to another.
Yes.
Laptop.
So if you're signed into both PCs with your Microsoft account, it'll let you copy on one, it'll sync automatically and copy to the other.
Nice.
This is opt-in, just so you know. It's not going to automatically synchronize your clipboard across all these.
Mm-hmm.
And you can also decide whether or not you synchronize everything or you synchronize just things that you say, sync this one item across all the clipboard.
Okay.
So it's super useful. Just folks need to get into the habit now of, Control C to copy, but Windows V to paste, not Control V to paste. So Windows V to paste, and once you start using it, you wish we had this forever and ever.
Yeah.
It's something that we need. There are some other, we fixed some bugs in Bluetooth MIDI, which is important to me.
Mm-hmm.
But we also did some more things for accessibility.
Okay, cool.
All right, so one of the things that my team works on is the Windows Community Toolkit. And we've had the gaze controls in there for a couple of releases, which enable you to use something like Tobii eye tracking to be able to control the screen with your eyes, right?
Mm, nice.
And so this is, both of my kids have Alienware PCs for their for gaming and stuff.
Yeah.
And both of them have the Tobii eye tracking built into the screen itself. So it's not a separate bar or anything. It's right there.
Cool.
And it's fun for games. But the real reason it's there is for people who have mobility issues, like maybe they can't move their hands, or maybe their hands move a lot by themselves. And the most efficient way, or sometimes the only way that they can interact with the computer is through eye control type devices.
Yeah.
Having that built into the operating system now, and it was beta in the previous version, it's now officially in there. Having that built into the operating system now means that if you have one of these compatible devices, you can use it like you use a mouse. You can use it to navigate around Windows, and everything is just built in there to work in a way that I think is really going to open up interaction with the computer to people who really couldn't use it very well before.
Right? And this all rolls out as part of just Windows Update, right? So if you get an update, then you will eventually get the...
Yeah, if you want the RS5 stuff, or the October 2018 update today, you can go and download it.
Okay.
Otherwise, it's going to roll out over the next week or so.
Yeah.
And we actually have a bunch of machine learning that runs behind that decides which PCs get updated first based upon the hardware on there.
So it will know that I'm going to do it demo tomorrow on another conference, so it won't update during the session.
It will update your laptop.
Oh,
well, so you can pause the updates.
Yeah.
I don't know if you can do that on Home or not, but at least on Pro, you can pause the updates. Mm-hmm. Yeah. I did that here because I knew that we're going to release. Yeah. I'm doing a keynote this afternoon. I don't want to get an update in the middle of that over Wi-Fi at the venue. That's not a good idea.
No.
I'm hoping the audience doesn't start updating in the middle of the session because we do rely on some bandwidth for the Wi-Fi. Sessions, right?
Yeah. And you talked about MIDI over Bluetooth for being important for you. I also saw that you have a session on music software. And I'm a musician myself. I use Bitwig.
Awesome.
You probably know that.
Yes.
So can you elaborate a bit more on that? What's the developer side that you do with music software?
Sure thing. So I work with a lot of the music application developer companies. Mm-hmm. I've shared the stage with Bitwig folks from there before.
Yeah.
A very cool company, by the way, and I love their product. They're doing some really fun things.
Yeah.
But we work with a lot of them to try to make it easier for them to have successful products on Windows.
Okay.
So our group as a whole works with top partners, like bringing in things like iTunes and other stuff to the Windows Store.
Mm-hmm.
At the same time, we're trying to help things like music partners adopt the new MIDI API, adopt some of the kind of low latency audio APIs that we've added in.
Yeah.
Excuse me. I'd mentioned BLE MIDI, and that is a standard that we voted on with the MIDI org at the NAMM show, I think two years ago or something like that. And then we've had Bluetooth MIDI built into Windows since the anniversary update.
Okay.
But we had some bugs in there that were blocking some companies because you couldn't do SysX transfers and stuff across it properly and things like that. So we fixed a bunch of those bugs in the previous update, which 1803. And then we fixed the last of the ones that we know about that was a blocker for companies in 1809 here. And so I'm looking forward to seeing some of these other companies like really kind of get on board with this. And I'm going to be speaking at an audio developer event in London in November and with one of the companies that's really interested in doing that kind of stuff.
Cool. Yeah.
So I heard a story that you can control your drone with your MIDI keyboard. What's that all about?
Yes. So, I'll give it away since most people here probably aren't going to be in the session this afternoon. So after we do this podcast, I have as one of my demos in this. It's just because I can. This makes zero. This makes absolutely no sense for somebody.
Those are the best guys.
Yeah. So it's like I have a Bluetooth MIDI keyboard controller by Korg, and I'm able to use that. Connected to my PC, and then my PC is also connected via USB to a Roland synthesizer, so I can play that.
Okay.
And then the next step of it is I also have it connected to a DJI Mavic Air drone over Wi-Fi. So when I hit a note, if the note is higher than the previous note, it'll go right.
Oh.
If it's lower, it'll go left.
Cool, cool.
I can also change it to go up, down, and whatever. There is a real chance that people will get hurt in this session. So, is it still okay?
Yeah.
So I'm cautiously optimistic that there will not be a lot of blood in here, but we'll see how this goes.
Yeah, not good.
Yeah.
Cool.
So and then more on the real developer side, because it's basically a real hardcore developer conference here.
So you think controlling a drone over MIDI is not a real developer scenario?
I would say it's a hardcore developer scenario. That's maybe not something we do every day.
Yeah.
Not for our customers.
I haven't seen that in a lot of specs, though, so yeah.
So we haven't found a bank that needs that.
Yeah. That will be a great customer.
Yeah.
So if you look at Windows development in particular, is there anything new on that front, like with UWP apps?
Yep.
Is there anything new for developers to know?
So here's some things that we have learned internally that I think are useful. I think it's fair to say nobody likes rewriting applications.
Nope.
Right? Yeah. So if you've got a super complicated WPF application.
Nope. Sorry.
My.
Well, that worked for quite a while.
There we go. You know, apparently I don't use enough products in my beard here or something. So if you are a WPF developer and you've had this application out there for years and years, you don't want to rewrite that into UWP, right? So one of the things that we've been talking about for a while is, depending on who you talk to, it has different names, things like XAML hosting or XAML islands, where you can take a chunk of UWP UI and host it in your WPF application.
Okay.
And so we have, so that some of that stuff has come out with the 1809 release here. There's a helper that is in the Windows Community Toolkit that makes it much easier for you to do that. It's still a stepping stone, like we're not done with this by any stretch, but it helps bridge that gap where we've always had APIs that you could use from WPF, but we haven't had any ability to use the UI. And so now I'm going to show some of the stuff with the UI.
Okay, cool. Okay. You can just embed it inside your application and interact with that.
Yeah, and it's not perfect yet, right? So, but I'm going to show how you can use the same kind of interaction that you did in a UWP application, and it's just in a shared DLL that is used in, by the WPF app as well.
Cool. Okay.
So that would, for instance, also allow me to use, I think there's this control for digital ink, which is only in UWP. Now I can simply add that kind of functionality to my WPF app by just embedding that control.
Yeah, I haven't tested the ink directly yet, so I can't say for sure if that's one of the ones that works or not, but that is the intent ultimately, is bring more of that stuff over into your W, and also not just WPF, Windows Forms and C++.
Okay.
Cool. Okay, cool.
So any other file and things you are going to do in your session?
No, I think one violent demo is enough. It's funny, I was testing this in the hotel last night, and I'm just imagining that people on the floor in the hotel were having nightmares in their sleep about swarms of bees coming to attack them or something, because I'm sure it was pretty loud in my room, but no deaths.
No hotel security.
No hotel security, and I still have all my fingers, so that's good. Yeah.
People should probably check out your demos. We were once with the demo that you did, Internet of Stranger Things.
Yes.
People are still talking about it, so that's pretty awesome. Yeah.
That was such a fun demo. The hardest thing with that was that big board, having to bring it everywhere. I eventually just left it with Channel 9. I'm like, you guys keep this. I can't ship it anymore. But that was such a fun demo.
Yeah, it was really cool.
Such a fun demo.
Cool. Okay.
Well, good luck with your session.
Yes. Thank you.
I'm definitely going to come there to see it.
Thank you.
You guys, thanks a lot for watching.
Yep.
Until next time.
Later.
Thank you.
Bye.